and works here at the gallery, her second exhibition here at the gallery. Sarah will be in conversation with you. We'll be talking for around about half an hour. I understand that you can interject any questions if you want to get her out and talk. And then we should have a little bit of time for questions at the end until about 5:45. So they will be talking about mostly works in this exhibition and recent works. So correct me if I'm wrong, but leading on from works from the Perez Museum and also the Wexner Center in Ohio, which include these movable elements, which I hope people had a chance to move if you haven't been doing during the opening. So it will be, as I said, new and recent works. If there's any information on earlier works of Sarah's that you want to know about, please do feel free to ask afterwards, or we have things in catalogues. To give a little introduction to Wouter as well, I'm going to read from my notes, Wouter, because you teach at the Department of Architecture and Urban Planning at Ghent University, as well as a yearly course at the Drama Department of the Royal Conservatory Antwerp, widely published on the Museum, Contemporary Art and Architecture in a variety of journals, and the author of Triple Bond, a selection of essays on art, architecture, and the museum, and Building for the Art, Museum Architecture from Central Pompidou to Tate Modern. So yes, you're all very welcome to join the opening afterwards, and I will hand over to Sarah and Rita.
Okay. Thank you, Jessica. Good evening. We've planned to have an informal talk to the work, amidst the work. And one of the things, we don't know how many of you have actually moved the works or tried to move the works. Yes, of course. Because it's quite important to understand we can perform them ourselves, or is there anyone who wants to try it out now before we start to talk? You don't need to be anxious to do so. Yeah, please.
Yes, and actually, I think it's important to the concept of the work that they can be repositioned through their full range of 360-degree motion. So, you know, as we move, we may be continuing to do that, and don't be shy about it, because they are developed in order to change.
Yeah, we'll wait a few minutes, and then we'll start. Simple, but I'll try to describe what I see, and from there on move to a more intricate description of what we're actually looking at. I think both elements exist of a column and a rotating beam made of glass, steel. This is structural silicone. But can you tell us a little bit about, because we're looking at two elements that are part of architecture that we know as architectural elements, columns and beams, but they relate to the existing architecture in a very particular fashion. But I'd like you to tell us a little bit more about how you, and there's a third element, we have the column and the beam and then the rotation device, or I don't know how you would call it. Can you tell us a little bit about how these things, what they are literally made of in particular, and how you construct them?
I think I'll start with just the kind of materiality of them. There are three discrete parts to each assembly, let's say, or combination. the three parts are basically two boxes and then this joint, an effective joint. And the joint has an orientation, which I'll get to in a minute. But the boxes are very, very simple structures. They are, if you stand, actually I'm going to turn it to face the larger group so you can see it in a section. So a section is basically a aluminum extrusion with a standard, this is largely, this channel is a kind of structural, what we call in America, unistrut. It's like a structural construction support for a larger modular system. And it's glued on with a structural silicone and basically a laminated heat strengthened glass. And the box is a kind of module. So you have a module that in this case is operating as a beam and another module that is operating as a column. And the entire assembly is inserted through, it's basically rolled onto this kinetic unit, which is its own discrete module. And if you come, let's say, away from the wall, I'm sorry to do this to you, but you're welcome to stay there. No seated, but yeah, you're welcome to slide. But I think of this as having an AB configuration, and I'll explain what that means for a second, which is the element rotates at 45 degrees to this axis. But in this case, the 45 degrees has different orientation to, let's say, the unit, the box unit. So in this case, it is the axis is parallel to the axis of the box, and in this case, it's at 180 degrees, or 90 degrees rather, to the axis of the box. So it has these two different orientations, which is why, in this case, the element moves between two horizontal positions as opposed to between a horizontal and a vertical position as it did in the past assemblies. And the other thing I'll say is that this kinetic joint unit is set up so that actually there are a series of nested bushings within it, which allow for this smooth rotation, which doesn't extend past a certain degree of pressure.
You continue to rotate them, you don't have to turn them back.
You never have to turn them back.
Yeah. And something about the size is you flip materials from column to beam, in the sense that this width equals this one, then you flip from the glass to steel.
That's correct. And so actually, the kind of availability of the extrusion is the determinant of the width and the narrowness of the element.
If you look at, basically the elements are the same. This one is similar to that column, this beam is similar to that one, but they seem different, but that's not the case, in terms of position.
That's true, and actually the AB kinetic elements are also the same, but they are inserted upside down. So because they're slid down the channels in reverse, it creates this mirrored condition, but they're actually just rotated. But just the part, not the entire assembly, is mirrored. But it creates a mirrored condition.
Can you tell us something about the fact that this distance is shorter than that one? Even though they rotate at the very middle of this element, which is hard to understand, but if you explain it, it becomes clear.
Yeah, so one of the questions that you had asked me earlier, and I'll try to rephrase this question, because I think that's pointing us towards the same thing, is that you had asked why the element is connecting at this position along the length of this, let's call it beam unit, and I'll turn it this way so you can see. So, because this is it appears off center, but one of the keys to a kind of even calibration of movement has to do with equilibrium, that kind of dynamic equilibrium, and that is achieved by distributing mass around the axis equally on all sides at all moments of rotation. So to do that, in fact, the center of this beam is not here, but is here in the center of this mass, and so it creates this sort of like one side.
about the title of the work, because you consistently, for a series of recent works, you use the letter S and then a number. Can you explain what that system of naming consists of?
So the titles of works, I'd say over the last 12 years now, have all consisted of combinations of letters and numbers. And that grows out of a much larger system that I have evolved that has to do with how spaces are next to each other and how works can mediate flow of things from one space to another. So in a much, let's say, simpler operation, a doorway or a window would allow something to flow from one zone to another zone, such as light or vision. But I started to notice that spaces, especially in contemporary institutional spaces, museum spaces, contemporary architecture, there's a lot less subdivision. So in fact, there's far fewer partition walls, and space is understood as a set of flows that happen through different apparatuses. And I was interested in thinking about modulating that flow without creating actual subdivision, like wall space. And so the S, to answer your question, is an interest in that problem. It has to do with this notion of a switch, which is also has everything to do with how this piece starts to change both the flow of our bodies in the space, but also the way one experiences the light coming from the overhead illumination, or how people are hearing sound in the space or engaging with one another as they're moving around.
Mm-hmm. So because what is key to this work, but also the previous works, is that they have an architecture of their own, you could say, but they also relate, or let's try and define the term to the existing architecture. And in this case also, you've done quite elaborate work to what was here in terms of structure to make the piece fit, or make the architecture fit the piece. So can you tell us a little bit how you relate to the architectural envelope, what kind of strategies you developed to bring in a piece, a complex piece like this?
So I think I'm really interested in what you notice in a world of architectural space and what you don't notice. And that has everything to do with what the hidden logic of a space is. And one of the logics that I think is a recurring logic of a space is how the space is subdivided and the patterns of subdivision as they relate to structure in a building. So, for example, the building grid is a kind of recurring thing that we don't think about, but totally determines how we inhabit a space. And in the past, I'd say 10 years, the work that I've developed has everything to do with modifying what exists and basically making a whole lot of work that is part of the work buried within a kind of slight modification, or I like to think of it as a thickening of the building. And that thickening then allows other things to become extremely visible. So to give you a very concrete example, in a previous work, if I had a piece that was passing through the floor of a building, the floor could become, could hold within it all the structural constraint of the piece, and you would only see, let's say, the void that was cut out of the floor. In this case, I think this building created a really exciting condition, because rather than see in this space a lot of walls or floor space, it suddenly became clear that the overhead beams were really driving the way you saw the experience of space, but you didn't really look at how the overhead beams worked. And there was a tremendous amount of modification to this space to allow this piece to occur. But the modification wasn't structural. It's actually, in some ways, about kind of calibrations of cladding, in a sense. So I'll be very specific. If you look down at the far end, you'll notice the beam at that far end of the gallery overhead that's running, let's say, on this axis is quite high and thin. and that beam is not at the same height or width as the beam that's below it holding up the end of that skylight. So all the beams are kind of staggered at different heights. You can see that for this beam here. So this big T was brought down, and the thickness, both the height of it, was made regular, and then the thickness of it was modified so that it appears as if this matches the thickness of the beam, which it doesn't, because there is a kind of artificial thickening of that condition. And it appears as if that matches the thickness of the beam, which means that when the entire structure of the, let's say, the arrangement of the possibilities of the work are aligned so that when you're standing on that axis, this edge condition drops down from this beam and sort of recreates this condition here. And this condition, when this rotates back, matches that axis there. And it also then extends the beam along this axis here. So the whole thing is that kind of move that I think, Luther, you're alluding to, which is the that the architecture is in some ways manipulated to generate a condition which isn't quite what is already there.
What is a particular effect of how you've just installed the two beams? Is that it virtually delineates a rectangular space here that then flips as soon as you put this one that way? So there are two impositions of the spatial logic on the existing architecture.
Yes.
But if we would historicize that, it's a type of practice. You could be put in a line of artists that take up architecture not only as a context but also as a subject, and in doing so, intervene within the architectural fabric. How would you relate your work, in a sense, because this afternoon you talked about massaging the architecture towards the work. How would you relate that to a tradition within which architecture was always used as an object to act against, something that you had to reveal something, you had to open up something or dismantle the architecture? You seem to be working almost a reverse engineering of architecture. How would you relate to a tradition that sits within institutional critique on from minimalism over concept? How do you relate to that type of work as an artist working today, not working in the 70s?
So I think that one of the consequences of a lot of that work is that it erased the potential of the spaces we inhabit. And it erased, it kind of obliterated it intentionally. And I think that if you think about how experience operates outside of architecture, just as lived experience, there's tremendous potential in all of the spaces we inhabit all the time. And it's, in some ways, I think, the challenge of making work to make that potential present, to make that potential felt. And so I don't think of this work as working against the building in any way. I think the building offers a set of potential conditions which it then wants to make evident, but also make evident in a way that are not apparent from the existing conditions, and part of that is a kind of sleight of hand, but the sleight of hand is not in here. The sleight of hand is, in this case, buried in the ceiling, and it has to do with what's perceived and what's made invisible. So I think of it as a much more generative act that I'm not interested in. But I think the institution, I also want to say something else. I think that since that period of time, the whole notion of what that institution is radically changed. So it means that what we're, as makers of things within those boundaries, what we're dealing with are totally different things.
Because in saying so, you bring me to, you seem to efficiencies of architecture, but rather to the potential and the promise. And so invariably, especially it works with the tiny piece, the tiny smaller piece around the corner, is that there the architectural associations are pretty rapid in the sense that you see images that could come from Archicram, Cedric Price. How does that work influence you, or how does it come in, or how does it play? Because it speaks to architecture in a completely different fashion, and the work seems to say also something towards the potential of architecture, as the work did at the time, like Price, or about future potential.
So one of the things I think is increasingly wonderful about the potential of architecture is about the time of being in a location. And I think one of the really extraordinary aspects of Price and Archicram, and I would say Kieser, we were talking about earlier, is that there is a time that is also, then the building starts to have its own time, and there is a kind of made evident time of a thing in its mechanization. And I'm really, really excited about that as a possible sort of strand of making something come to being. I don't know if I'm answering your question, but.
Oh, indeed, the reference of Kiesler is, I think, a really productive one, because it doesn't relate to it formally, as it doesn't look like Kiesler work, but it does take up some of the ambitions that he has in the sense of making emancipatory scenography or exhibition design that would engage the viewer and not necessarily disrupt, but rather insert more dynamic relationship between viewers, space, and artwork. And this work seems to point to that potential of architecture to do, because with Kiesler and his generation, it stayed with a promise, because technology was not as far developed as it is now. And in your case, technology is a very present tool, also spatially. So can you tell us something about 3D modeling programs you use? Because these, to conceive, you told something really beautiful this afternoon. You said, well, if things are merely about the potential, maybe I'm not that interested. I'm really interested in things that succeed. What would it be that here you succeed rather than solely being a drawing, as Kiesler made many drawings,
so
like crazy drawings that would stay a model?
So I think I have so much to say about that, but I think that the notion, I wouldn't think of it as success. Like if the piece succeeds, I would say that the piece works. And I don't mean works like it works as an artwork, I mean it works like a machine. It effectively works. And it could be a machine that is not an operable machine, meaning it doesn't move, but it's still operating, meaning it's sort of working. And I think the reason that's significant to me is that I believe that the potential of a kind of proposed imagination, which is essential to, I would say, living or to reimagining the world we inhabit, comes from the material world. It comes from what we see and inhabit all the time. It comes, and those material things are also drawings, actually. But I think that the only possible way for me to imagine the potential of this condition as a kind of changeable space has to do with its actual realization and experiencing and changing. And I think that those things, they feed each other. So its material manifestation feeds what then can be imagined from it. And it doesn't get you there if you're simply proposing it as a kind of utopian projection.
But still the work has a propositional nature to it. It seems to point to possibility in maybe, let's phrase it this way. Architecture is a very stable object, very fixed. And the artwork is always the thing that moves. You seem to make something that marries the two.
So I think that architecture is always moving. And so I'm interested in making that evident. I mean, it is always moving, and how do you make that evident? We are always moving in it, and it is always moving around us, and we are always in this kind of extraordinary phase of choreography with the building where it happens. So the challenge for me becomes, how do you make that perceptually evident? And how does that have its own time? So the other thing that's really interesting to me about this opening tonight is the opportunity to watch people, to see how people are going to engage with this condition that I haven't yet experienced. And that in turn will then feed how I think about what this work is, but it will have its own time. So a person moving it will have the time of moving it, the person standing in the room will watch them moving it, and they will have that time of watching that person moving it, and then the light will change, and the day will change, and it will start to get dimmer and dimmer in here. All of those times start to overlap, and they start to cycle through. And I think that's what I want this piece to offer.
So then, you beautifully phrased it. So you would consider your work not as a model for movement in architecture, as movable architecture, but rather as models or devices that allow you to understand and calibrate your own experience of continuous movement within architecture. So these are not models for how architecture should move, but rather, we talked about it, like, can you use the word tool or instrument? I think that would play down the quality of it. But nevertheless, these are things you could, I'll use the term, use to arrive at understanding about how we experience space, how limited, basically, also our understanding of space is.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And I would say, what we count as the thing, like what you're saying, these things, is a work of a sleight of hand, which includes then changes to the whole condition of the space. So, yes, let's say that is true, but that is true through the manipulation of the total space. And that even the making evident the thing, or the thing that changes, the kind of register of change, is part of the work then.
And I'd like to ask you something about the scale of the work. This is work that adopts the scale of the architecture, and the architecture adopts literally the scale of the work. There's something else happening. Maybe we can move to the other room. Of scale of this piece, especially when it was moved like this. Which, having been trained in architecture, it was hard for me not to read this as a model, as a bridge or a plot. And so something really strange happens, that this piece seems in perception larger, what it proposes, than the literality of that piece. Or am I just projecting my own experience?
Well, I think that I hadn't thought about that until we just were sort of discussing it. But I do think it has everything to do with how the history of the window works versus the history of building structure, because the window is always representing something else. It's like the painting. And so this niche form signifies a kind of picture image, whereas the column is not a representation at all. But I also think there's something about it then also mimicking the scale of a model and this being much more human size. So because this is the scale at which the model could exist, and I think as a model it's actually kind of fascinating because what is this? This is a cliff that it's like an extrusion of a massive, like the side of an iceberg. Like where is this site that we are observing? But I mean the wall, where is that? But in any case, I do think it's interesting for me to consider that problem together. That's really interesting.
I just, and then we'll move over to questions. Practical about this piece comes with a wall. Can you describe the specifics of this piece? Because it's clear that this wall has been constructed around the steel and glass structure. But how does it work? Can it extend, or what should always be the same in this piece?
So the thickness of the wall should always be the same. That's actually a very critical factor, and the end condition.
This one.
Yes.
But it could go up.
Yeah, it could go up or it could go up. Yeah.
And then I'm going to ask one more thing, because it relates to the history of this gallery. This gallery has a history and also a reputation of showing artists from the historical avant-garde. They have worked by Naum Gabo, Ochenko, Fantomovlo. It seems that your work makes a beautiful historical loop in combining the belief in the capacity of architecture, but also of technology and the emancipatory potential of that. So how do you read, or how do you relate to that? Because we've talked about 60s and 70s neo avant-garde. They all looked at what people in the 20s and 1910s did. And invariably your work brings up that those references, like Rochenko, you could see models of his if you look at the work.
So I think this is an amazing place to get to do a project like this, because this place has housed so many of those works. And also because those works, unlike many of the other references, I think point to a potential that is only just beginning to be explored. And also the contextual frames of that potential were totally different, both technologically and also institutionally. And I think it's amazing actually to have the support of a place, I mean, in this case, a commercial gallery that will support this work that I think is actually really challenges a lot of those things. It's really, I feel really lucky.
Okay, that's a nice note to end.
Yeah.
And I open up the floor to questions.
I'm going to ask, eventually, is that a sex?
I don't think so. So, for example, walls are everywhere. So this work is specifically installed, but this, because this piece is modular, this work can exist in many configurations. So this could become a lintel, meaning that what is currently a column could become a lintel, and that other element could become a divider. So the answer is I would say no. And the titles in some ways, just to say one other thing, are about that interchangeability of location. But every time they're installed, they change.
This piece gives me Rubik's cube stress, so I don't remember how to put it back the way it was before.
Okay, yeah.
Could you help me?
Yeah.
Because I have a question about when it was like that.
This way?
Yes. Thank you.
Uh-huh.
So when I saw this piece for the first time up in there, I'm happy that you said it has a representational quality, also the two-dimensionality of it, because I was wondering, it took me a while to understand what was going on, if destabilization or confusion are, that's what I felt. What is this? Is it? It looks like something I might know, but it looks like maybe blinds, or I could see that it was modular, but I didn't anticipate that you could do Rubik's Cube things with it. So are these things like visual confusion and destabilization of what it resembles something but not really? Are those factors you count into your work?
I'm really interested in the possibility of making a perceptual delay.
Yes.
So that when you encounter it, you have to rethink what you are looking at.
Yeah, that's what happens. So.
Yes, that's very important to me. I think that time is what is required to reestablish an orientation in a location.
Yeah.
But I like the possibility of being optimistic, but I'm really interested in anxiety. I'm really interested in the anxiety of, increasingly, last few months, the anxiety of a potential self-collision that generates from motion. So you're talking about this Rubik's Cube anxiety of, I think that's really interesting because it creates a kind of tension that isn't comfortable. It's like the elegant object versus the uncomfortable object. I think that discomfort, anxiety, I don't know what you want to call it, is really generative. And I think generative may be positively generative. It's not anti-architecture, but it opens a question. What are we looking at? Where are we? What are we doing? And I don't know that I'm answering your question fully. Of the last two works that move. Films is the wrong word. I've made 60-minute clips. And tomorrow we are going to try that here. But it's really amazing to try that because you have this amazing set of variables. You have the moving camera, you have the moving work, and you have the moving people. And it's wild. So yeah, it's just really, but it's very new to me.
So you're going to be doing it with moving
camera. Yes, that's very important because the person is never still.
So it's like a ballet.
Yeah, it's like a ballet. It's like a ballet. It's really yeah.
How long will this film be?
Probably not more than 60 seconds. I don't know.